My camera is drifting again.
Again, there it comes. Hi, everybody. This is Allison from Alley Cat Creations. How are you? Please like, share, and subscribe to my channel if you have yet to do so. And if you get anything from my work, a connect the dot, an epiphany, a mind explosion, a new book to read, a new author to explore, please consider supporting my work. All the links are at the bottom of the description, and there are new things I just put up on the website. Hearts. New, well, I only got one done, but there I'm working on some new types of pyramids with larger gemstones in there. Artwork. I got some very nice new artwork up there. Different sections, so you have to look through. Skulls are up as well. So go check out my website, alleycatcreations211.com. If you see something you like, please email me because I do everything privately. I just can't afford the insurance and all of the other stuff that comes with a business. So check my website out, and email me if you're interested. That's how I could stay fed and supported. Sorry, I haven't done a video in 2 days. I put in adoption papers almost a month ago for a kitty named Oki. And Oki, unfortunately, was adopted out. It was really sad because I really connected to that cat. But the woman's like, go back and see if you like any other cats. Well, yesterday I brought home Heartsy and Moo. They're cow cats. They're not tuxedo, but they look tuxedo, but they're cow cats. And fell in love with them. I'm renaming them Odin and Freya. They're Heartsy's the dad. He's three. And Moo is the daughter. She's two. And it's hard to change names at that stage because they've been used to them, but I'm going to see if I can do that. I'm very excited, but the last 2 days I was getting the house prepared for the kitties. Just scrubbing everything down. I don't know. I'm watching, they're in my cat room right now. I'm watching their behavior to see if they're chewing on wires or they're wanting to jump up a high, on stuff, because I don't like when the cats jump on furniture besides couches, bean bags, and that's it. I have to see how their behavior is before I let them out in the rest of the house. And down here I need to scrub, because I do a lot of my sanding and stuff down here. I don't know if they'll come down, but they're getting acclimated. So the last 2 days have been a roller coaster of fun and excitement. So I'm back at it. They're sleeping right now. I'm really, really excited. And we're going to do the message of Aquaria taking Jericho. This shall be very interesting. Quote, "And ye shall compass the city, all ye men of war, and go round about the city once. Thus shalt thou do 6 days, and seven priests shall bear before the ark seven trumpets of ram's horn, sorry. And the seventh day ye shall compass the city seven times, and the priests shall blow with the trumpets. And Joshua saved Rahab the harlot alive, and her father's household, and all that she had, and she dwelleth in Israel even unto this day." End quote, Joshua. Jericho is a historical city situated 5 miles north of the Dead Sea. At one time, it was quite extensive and was considered the most fruitful spot on earth, being described by historians as a tropical oasis set down in a temperate zone. It has been partially devastated a number of times, but never entirely destroyed, nor is there any historical evidence to corroborate the extraordinary and spectacular siege described in the biblical narrative. The story of its capture By Joshua, we must therefore take as purely symbolical. Today, Jericho consists of but a small hamlet in the midst of an important fruit-growing center. This is further evidence that it was never utterly destroyed and its place left desolate. The biblical story of that enterprise is so full of unnecessary and wanton cruelty, and also so full of mystical metaphor and marvelous spiritual truths, that its symbolical and mystical intent is beyond question. For only divine inspiration could tell so bloody a tale in so simple a way that every incident, almost every word, held a wealth of spiritual teaching. We may well ask why, in the symbology of spiritual ideals, bloodshed and cruelty should be used. The answer is that the spiritual ideas to be expressed were given to the prophet, but were expressed as such ideals always are in the metaphor of the race, though. And as at the time the Hebrew civilization was crude and cruel, the only way to express the overcoming and conquering was through fighting and killing. Similar metaphor would be necessary even today to express similar ideas, although perhaps not so crudely expressed in using modern terms and illustrations. It must be remembered that all true inspiration is not given in words. The overshadowing consciousness illumines, inspires the mind of the seer, so that a realization of divine truth or ideal is grasped. This realization must then be given out or uttered by the inspired one in the best language he can command to express or at least symbolize the essence of the realization attained. This explains the difference between inspiration and astral dictation, even from advanced teachers in the invisible realms. Inspiration is by no means a word-for-word recording of information given by some divine being or by some spiritual teacher or master, for were it so, instead of being inspired, we would become mere puppets, automata, or automatic writers, with no need to think for ourselves and without responsibility for what we wrote. In the divine mind, there is stored up the ideals of all that is to be manifested, as well as all the truth that has been grasped and expressed by man since the beginning. To the degree that he can rise his consciousness to correlate with the divine mind or reservoir of wisdom, the seer can draw upon it and grasp those phases of truth which the great custodians of truth deem it wise to have revealed by him at the time. For an impenetrable veil is drawn over all else. Therefore, it depends upon the intellectual and philosophic, as well as the spiritual and psychic training of the seer, whose truths are expressed even after full further explanation by his spiritual teacher. This accounts for the differences in the various ways trained seers express truths in regard to the same subject. This is the method together with the theophany, by which the books of the Bible and all other great scriptures were revealed and later compiled. These are also the methods by which the teaching of the order of Christian mystics are received. They are then expressed in the best terms the agents can use, interpreted, explained, and corroborated by examples from science and nature. The interpretations are further corroborated by quotations from various scriptures and other recognized and authoritative sources or expressions of the same truths. This explains, as nothing else can, much of the blood-curdling metaphor of the Old Testament, as well as many symbolic teachings of the New Testament, couched in what seems today to be gross and repellent language. Jericho was chosen to symbolize that city which each and every soul must conquer when he has built into his life the strength of the 12 stones taken from the Jordan and has stood in their midst, the sacred spot concerning which the captain of the Lord's host said to Joshua, "Put off thy shoes from off thy feet, For the place whereon thou standeth is holy ground. Only as we take from our own understanding feet, all hampering coverings, shoes, can we see the vision of this mighty angel, our higher self, standing in the center of our circle of life. Note how they said the mighty angel, our higher self. The meaning of the name Gilgal is a circle, hence the 12 stones which Joshua had taken from Jordan and pitched in Gilgal were arranged in a circle. As the Druid stones were later arranged, the circle of the zodiac. At once we see that the mystical meaning of these stones, which must be gathered one by one from the mist of Jordan and whose forces must be built into the character of each soul who passes over that river dry shod, is the balancing and conquering of the forces which come from the 12 signs of the zodiac. Symbolically, each perfected soul is represented as a sun initiate standing in the midst of a circle where all the forces are focused, not being ruled by, but ruling his stars. We read that when Joshua was by Jericho, or when he had taken his place as a sun initiate, he lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, there stood a man with his sword drawn in his hand, the sword of the spirit of truth. When challenged by Joshua, he answered, as captain of the hosts of the Lord, am I now come? In other words, when he had obtained this step, Joshua both recognized and gave obedience to his higher or divine self, who henceforth dwelt within the personality, and he became one with the Father in heaven. The captain of the host, or the higher or divine self, merely overshadows and strives to inspire and guide the personality of human self until, through the initiation and realization of the personal self, the divine self is invited to enter into his earthly temple, the body, when it has been properly purified and prepared, and dwell therein. Then will he come as he did to Joshua, with his sword drawn, the sword of truth, whose two edges cut both ways to drive out the polluting forces which have been dwelling in the personality, selfish or impure thoughts and desires, perversity, inharmony, and sickness, and also to cut clean and true the line between good and evil, that there may no longer be excuse for ignorance. When this attainment is reached, Joshua can then proceed to take Jericho, not merely in his strength as a man, but as a mystical son of God and in a son initiate. Even though he had already led the children of Israel, all his faculties and creations, dry shod over Jordan, and had gathered the forces from all the zodiacal signs, yet only when he stood in the center and had been baptized by the Holy Ghost and become a son initiate, could he complete the task of taking Jericho? One meaning of Jericho is a fruitful place. By some, it is called the moon god city and the city of palm trees. Most varieties of palm trees, which beautiful and stately, bear no edible fruit and give but little shade. Hence, they symbolize pride, well-being, and contentment with physical conditions and with little spiritual food. But the fundamental meaning of Jericho is the city of desire, a place of pleasure, and the fruitfulness of our thoughts, acts, and desires for physical well-being, in which we dwell contently until our Joshua demolishes the wall which shuts us away from the larger life. Jericho is also the home of the moon, the symbol of intuition. The moon goddess represents the aspect of the divine knower, corresponding to one aspect of the great mother, the fruitful bringer forth of all things, both good and evil. For as the moon shines only by the light it receives from the sun, so the great mother brings forth only that which is implanted by the father, or as karma, that which is implanted by man. Therefore, in man, as in nature, Jericho would symbolize the manifestation of that stream of creative force, which brings forth through thought and act as well as sex, that which man either ignorantly or foolishly has sown. It is because man has the power both to modify his creations through thought and literally to create thought forms that he is a creator rather than merely a procreator, like the animals, which can bring forth only after their kind or pattern set for them. Hence, to take Jericho is to master this force, purify it with divine fire, and make it subservient to the will of the higher self, destroying all but the silver and the gold, the vessels of brass and of iron, all those phases of desires and pleasures, save those that are true and pure, and those which, although as common as iron and brass, are needful as vessels of service, all of which must consecrate and place in the treasury of the house of the Lord. The esoteric teaching tells us that the moon is the mother of the earth, and not a satellite cast off from the moon, from the earth, and that it was while man was evolving on the moon chain of globes that he set up the karma, which necessitated many of the experiences of the separated sexes, although the separation of the sexes was a necessary experience destined in the course of man's manifestation on earth. The seeds of that karma were planted in then embryonic planet, which was destined to become the earth. It was because of these karmic seeds that a planet producing man in separated sexes was evolved, that upon it this problem could be given expression and be worked out and the wisdom of the experience gained. Hence, this earth is the only planet where the problem of separated sexes exists, yet which by the solution and victory of all that is implied in that problem will become the sun of a new system. For through the proper solution of this great problem, we will change the condition, first of ourselves, then of all humanity, and finally of the planet itself. Through the many experiences this question has brought us and the suffering it has entailed, when we learn all is lessons, we will have become as gods, knowing the good as well as the evil. The deeply mystical teaching symbolized in the story of Jericho would of itself stamp the Bible as the most marvelous book of occult wisdom, one in which so few words and symbols indicate and include so much. Pause. Hi. Holy crap. Says everything that I say constantly on a daily basis to so many people. That whole paragraph. Limitations and separations, we chose this. We chose to separate. We chose to individuate. We chose these things. We chose these things on a small scale, large scale, medium scale, the whole entire SmackDown. We chose this. So when you can come into the awareness that you chose this and own it, and accept it and work with it instead of going against it, things would be so much better. And you have to walk through the experience in order to gain the wisdom. That's why many of us have some fucked up lives. If we didn't walk through the muck, we would not know the rainbow that comes at the end of the trail. We wouldn't know. And once you understand these things, your awareness expands. Your little 3D mind starts expanding into the higher frequencies. Your definitions broaden. They're no longer 3D definitions. They start moving and shifting with the expansion. I'm excited because here again, I am validated. And I read these books with you. It's like a reaction video to books. Only when, like Joshua, we have taken off our shoes or bared our understanding and have recognized the captain of the host of the Lord and have bowed before him, become one with him, and have been endowed with his power as Jesus was endowed with power at his baptism, willing to follow whithersoever he leadeth. Are we ready to take Jericho? Only as we recognize our divine leader standing in the midst of our zodiac and have become one with him, realizing that he was brought us out of the wilderness and across Jordan dry shod, and we have provided our willingness to follow his commands, can we really capture Jericho and ultimately possess the promised land? But once we have had this experience, we can depend upon our leaders to show us how to take this city. Pause here. Since the great lesson of this planet is that of the mastery of sex, the control of the sex force and magnetism, and the use rather than abuse of all the forces of this wonderfully fruitful city in the valley of the valley in Jordan is the great task before us, for all its fertility must be utilized and its fruits consecrated to the feeding of the children of Israel, all its poisonous waters made sweet, its streets cleansed from impurity and depravity, so that sickness and disease and death may no longer result from the miasma that arises from the decaying fruit thrown out and let to rot upon the ground. The neophyte must begin then with his first city in the promised land, but his task will be fully completed only when he reaches the New Jerusalem, where the tree of life brings forth its 12 manner of fruits from the healing of the nations, also for the healing of all sorrows and the wounds we have received in the many battles fought while gaining the victory over Jericho and conquering the promised land. Pause. We're here right now. We're doing this right now. We are energetically purging all other lives, selves, incarnations, concurrent, simultaneous lifetimes, different dimensional densities of us. We're clearing all that through this body right now. And we're all walking toward that promised land. We're all trying to achieve that New Jerusalem that Kiza Enoch and other books have given us to this beauty mint. And the idea that we're just going to go like that in a snap. I mean, we could change our own timelines. We could do, but the core of the lessons need to be learned before you can walk and cross into that frequency. You could change your frequency. That doesn't mean that what you have done doesn't need to be cleaned up, because it absolutely does. We all volunteered to come back here to clean up the crap and the mess that our other selves left. So until this is exactly what is happening now. We are doing this now. We got to clean up and purify this humanity before we can jump onto a new earth. So that's going to take a long time. And that's based on if all of humanity comes together and unifies, we can get this done way quicker. And yeah, you could shift right now to the promised land, but you're going to be pretty lonely over there. There are people there, just not enough. But you were tasked to help clean up and to shift. And that's what many of us are here doing, is helping the shift, helping people realize and clean up and purify themselves, get in better shape. New beginnings. And we're all doing that now. So keep up the good work. Therefore, let it be plainly understood that the taking of Jericho means conquering, subjugating, and putting to proper use all the creative forces and functions of the body and mind, whether they manifest through sex, thought, word, or deed. We must indeed capture this city of desire and rule it. But because in the course of our evolution, we have sown seeds of bitter weeds in this fruitful city, as we come into our spiritual majority and begin our soul's work in earnest, we must recognize our weeds, pull them up, and begin to make the earth a better place to live in. An advanced theater of action. See, theater. Stepping stone to ever higher fields of evolution. I call those stair steps. And one of the first steps is capturing from the king of the world, King Desire, the city which we have only too long permitted him to surround with walls, that the debauchery he calls pleasure may be hidden from the world's gaze. Let us consider how the Christian man captures the city of the desire. There are many misguided teachings on the subject, and students confronting this important task are often told that once they have stepped into the stream, Jordan, and taken the vows or adopted the resolutions necessary to lead to the truly mystic life of neophyte, they must avoid Jericho altogether, must even deny its existence, must not at all interfere with the rule of its king, even though he bids fair to subjugate the entire world, must utterly ignore all its fruits and pleasures, calling them only temptations and seductions. But Joshua, even while still in the wilderness, sends out two men as scouts to investigate Jericho. These two, we have said, symbolize two of our positive faculties, which we will call aspiration and reason, or intuition and judgment. While he is passing through that which he is symbolized by the Jordan, the neophyte must send forth his newly unfolding intuition and judgment into the city of desire, that he may understand it. In other words, he must face himself and take cognize of all the forces he finds within. Find out how to conquer them and see if much of the wonderful fruitfulness of the city cannot serve in the house of the Lord as vessels of gold and silver and of brass and iron. This, however, does not mean that we should indulge in the debaucheries of Jericho, for while some maintain that we can never know and understand the temptations of the flesh until we have experienced them, until we have eaten of their fruits and have proven that they bring only suffering and death, such teaching is but sophistry. For we sow the seed of suffering and death and fulfill the prophecy. And the day ye eat thereof, ye shall surely die. Just as inevitably, if we eat merely for experience, as if we eat to gratify the flesh. Hence, by such an act, we are kept out of Eden, lest we eat of the tree of life and live forever in the renegated state. When the scouts came to the city, they found its inhabitants very antagonistic to the approaching hosts of Israel. And just so to do, intuition and judgment find little to encourage them when they begin to explore a city of desire, for the desires of the flesh even seek to capture and kill the messengers of the spirit. But the scouts at last find a dwelling place upon the wall and are given lodging by Rahab, a woman who was a harlot. Surely a most astonishing place for the messengers of the Lord to dwell. Yet she took them into her home and hid them and thus saved their lives. Who can this harlot be? She is love dressed in the habiliments of King Desire. When the city of fruitfulness provided for her children by the divine mother becomes the vessel of King Desire, love establishes her dwelling upon the wall. For although she has fallen from her high estate and has forgotten that she is the destined bride of the Christ, she still waits and watches upon the wall, ready to help and cheer all who come to her sick of living on the husks or needing her touch to start them on their long journey back to their father's home. Even though she has played the harlot with many lovers, Yet she will ultimately return unto the Lord. And even though their mother hath played the harlot, she that conceived them hath done shamefully. Yet since their mother is love, when we take the city, she must be saved. And even though when clothed in mere animal desire, she seduces all who come seeking only pleasure and animal gratification, yet in reality, she is divine, for God is her father, and her mother is the great bringer forth of all good. All whose intuition and judgment can penetrate her disguise in their search for truth, and who are willing to accept it and do not seek to contaminate it with preconceived opinions, find her an immortal goddess, often turning the seeming pleasures of lust into gall and wormwood, and bring forth from such illicit union only the cankering worm that dieth not. Let all who send out their scouts guard well against her wiles, lest, in the lively of desire, she lull them to sleep with her seductiveness and ensnare both intuition and reason in the nets of mere animal indulgence. She is represented as having her house upon the wall, firstly, because her real dwelling place is above the mere animal pleasures of the city, even though she descends to them from time to time at the command of the king desire, and secondly, because those who are bringing forth merely through the pleasures of the senses, when they find true love, even though it be not yet purified and ideal, have scaled the wall of the city of desire, or have risen above the limits of sensual pleasures, and have reached point where they can at least glimpse the promised land that lies beyond. Yet because her real name is love, and love is immortal, if the scouts are wise, fearless, and strong of will, and do not yield to flattery and seduction, she will hide them from the enemies who will take their lives. Even today, we find a remnant of this divine immortal love in the heart of many a harlot who wears the livery of King Desire and is forced to do his bidding. It is a fact well known in esoteric teaching that as long as a true love for anything outside of self is in the heart of the personality, the higher self will not be fully separated from the personality, even if that love be but a vibration of affection for an animal or a flower. For love is a cord, no matter how fragile, but which communion with the divine can be set up and over which the higher self can pour its force into the personality to redeem it. We are told that Rab let the scouts down from the wall at night by a cord, and that she made a covenant with them that as a reward, she and her mother and father and all her household should be saved when the Israelites took the city. Thus, our intuition and reason often saved by love, and in return, love and her household be recognized and saved by the scarlet thread. Many there be who play the harlot, but those who are truly of the household of love wear the scarlet thread made up of many twisted strands of loving thoughts and kind deeds, dyed scarlet with the force of unselfishness and self-sacrifice. That which is generally called scarlet in the Bible is today called royal purple, the color supposed to be worn only by kings and queens. Hence, the scarlet thread symbolizes livery of the King of Kings, the royal garment of sincerity and truth. Rab may not have the entire robe of the divine king, only a scarlet thread or a cord, but enough of an insignia to proclaim that true love is of the king's household. We are told Rab dwelleth in Israel even unto this day. Hence, whenever we find the scarlet thread, we must recognize and save Rab and all her household. For her scarlet thread proclaims that her true household is the household of the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and that her father is a father in heaven and her mother is divine love. But in thus save her, we must take her out of the city of desire and see that she dwells thereafter in Israel. How plainly is indicated the way we are to capture the city of desire. For 6 days, the six periods or cycles of the creative week, Must we quietly and yet steadfastly follow the priests who carry the Ark of the Covenant around the city, making one complete round each day? All this time we must follow silently, for Joshua had commanded the people, saying, "Ye shall not shout nor make any noise with your voice, neither shall any word proceed out of your mouth until the day I bid you shout. Then shall ye shout." This applies as truly to the followers of the Christ in these days. How often do we hear some, when they have scarcely compassed the city for the first time, in which they recognize the tardiness, I don't know that word, of the pleasures of the world and feel quite superior because they fancy they have grown away from such things, shout loudly of the foolishness and wickedness of it all, making such noise with their voices in what they think is an effort to bring the inhabitants of the city to a realization that all they hold most dear can see no harm in it is utterly wrong, and made calling to them to leave their pursuits, even their duties, to break away from the cities and all they love and join the procession outside the city. Again, in the second day or cycle, many do much shouting and proclaiming to the citizens of the city concerning their own superiority and godliness, and boasting of the great city that Joshua shall build upon the ruins of the one they are about to destroy. On later days, when they see that their individual shoutings do not cause the walls to fall, many loudly criticize the priests who bear the ark as to how they bear it, how they walk, how they blow the trumpets, and so forth, quite sure that they themselves have been chosen to bear the ark. They could have made a much more impressive appearance. Also, often the notes of the ram's horn displease many who are nevertheless determined following Joshua around the city. A ram's horn symbolizes both power and intellectual leadership. Hence, the seven priests who bear seven trumpets of ram's horns correspond to the seven churches which were in Asia, spoken of in Revelation, namely seven, or more correctly speaking, a perfect number of spiritual leaders, each marching before the Ark of the Covenant, each blowing continually on his own horn, or giving out the message of the mysteries of the kingdom of God symbolized by the Ark, each in his own way and to the best of his ability. If we remember that only as the hosts march silently in their own places can the mystic potency of the blast of the horns make the walls of the city totter, we will understand that as a host, we have not yet compassed the city even once, for we have not yet learned to listen to, let alone obey, the first command of Joshua to keep silent. Many who have been called and chosen to march in the lead, instead of keeping silent until Joshua bids them shout, are now talking and boasting loudly of all the inner teachings and promises given them by Joshua, conditionally as a guardian, if they prove worthy. They are thus distracting the attention of the people from Joshua, and because of such orations, the hearers stand still instead of marching silently and quietly around the city. The moment even a few stand still, they break the rhythm which many marching feet create. Hence, instead of helping to make the walls of Jericho weaken, they stimulate the curiosity of the inhabitants who come forth from the city to listen to and argue with them, and often accuse such leaders of being but one themselves. I'm being channeled, sorry. Why have many of us felt the need to exit out of a lot of the political scene? And even spiritual circles. It's not because we've become quiet, because we absolutely need to share our experiences to help awaken people. But the stammer of the hate the shouting out the rooftop treason and this and that and the other thing. Unless a constitutional scholar and the military that took an oath for the Constitution and we the people actually do their jobs, which they should have done a very long time ago, and they never. Oh, well, there's good and evil, Allison. There's good military and bad military, Allison. Well, they never did their oaths. And not to disrespect any veteran, because you can't just do one person. You need a whole army to stand up and to actually uphold their oaths. There's been a constitutional crisis, and the wall has been built up. And the people who shout out the law the loudest aren't really doing much besides, yeah, we're educating everybody, great. But at what point does someone actually take action to say, have you read your effing Constitution, your Articles of Confederation? What the hell? Oh, well, the evil people had it controlled. Okay, so what are we supposed to do? While many as individuals have obeyed and have journeyed safely through Jericho and onward over the rugged hills until they may almost be in sight of the heavenly city, the New Jerusalem, yet we look around the world sadly and are dismayed to see the gay white way of Jericho still in full blast, and see how apparently futile are the efforts of the hosts of the Lord to demolish its walls. Yet all we can do as individuals is to go and on obeying the command of Joshua, marching each in his place and keeping silent until we are told to shout. We may not personally like the priests who blow on the horns, and we may feel that we are in their place, we could do much better. Or we may have a ram's horn of our own we seek to blow and may believe that we can cheer the marching hosts if we blow upon it. But only when all obey the chosen Joshua and follow the lead of the armed men, those who have put on the whole armor of God and the great mass of followers rewarded follow on, all keeping silent until Joshua bids them shout, will Jericho be taken. When the seventh day comes, the Sabbath day of the Lord, when the perfect number of God's chosen priests are commanded all to blow together the one note, only then shall the people shout the shout of victory, and the one note shall be the great, the grand Amen. For while the seven priests are marching and leading the people through the six periods of unrest and struggle, each blows his horn in his own key or gives the teachings in his own language, thus helping those who are naturally affinitized to his note key. But if he has been the true priest and has given of his best, he will in time reach the seventh period and will then be able to sound his note so true and harmoniously that it will vibrate to the chord of universal harmony. And when each of the seven strikes the chord, all will be attuned and bring about the victory, for all differences will have vanished. Each will realize that all the others have been blowing but a part of the one chord, and only when this perfect harmony and at one mint among those who are priests have been obtained, will the walls of Jericho fall. This does not mean any loss of personality for the priests. Each will still sound his own note, but will sound it in such perfect accord with the others that they will bend into one note of victory. So much as we individuals gather together all our higher faculties and march at last once around Jericho every time its temptations and allurements are presented to us, but silently, without talk and without fighting, merely marching valiantly and allowing the vibrations of the trumpets to accomplish the work, for the time of utter destruction of the wall has not yet come. Thus we shall ultimately conquer. Also, the priests in us, the radioactivity of our seven sacred centers and our higher ideals and aspirations, which lead us Godward, must sound in our lives their notes of victory over the city of desire, if it is to be captured and made a useful servant of the Christ. For individually, we each must conquer our personal city of desire and preserve all its good vessels, ere we can march in the great possession of the hosts of the Lord, who shall conquer it for the world. Next time I will read The Vain Show. That shall be very interesting. But this entire chapter is what I speak about and what a lot of people are starting to be in recognition with, that it's the silent majority marching around, doing our thing, but stopping, not getting attracted to those things that are just distractions from us doing the real work. We have to start somewhere, and where a lot of us have been circling for a very long time silently. Now we're speaking. We're getting the truth out, but we're moving more. If we take this and apply it spiritually, we are all spiritually moving forward. We're scrapping the nonsense, the distractions, the programs, the narratives that are no longer serving humanity. We're purging all the things that no longer serve humanity and within ourselves. We're marching along. We haven't come to the one chord of unity yet, where we can break down the matrix. We're doing it slowly and on a large scale. So we could take that as an allegory for what we're all doing right now. Many people are still in the awareness of this and that. Oh, shiny objects, shiny gold and silver, shiny, shiny, shiny. Oh, everything's going to be okay. I don't have to do any work because this is going to be handed to me and I don't have to worry. Oh, the stock market is crashing and this, that, and the other thing, and it's all distraction. Like I said, if it happens, fucking fantastic. That would help me because I maybe have a month's worth of bills left, and then I'm going to have to figure out how the hell I'm living. Not fun. I will start working, so I will have something coming in, but it's not going to be enough. And the fact of the matter is, I'm putting my faith into the universe. Things will work out for me in my artwork and for other ventures that I'm going to hopefully get into after I know what my schedule is like. It's just very frustrating to see people still distracted without going in and doing the work on themselves, not transmuting negative energy, blaming everything on the outside world for their problems when the problems are stemming in all your lives from within. And that needs to be purged and healed. And it's not easy. It's not a cakewalk. It's hard and it's painful. It's years and lifetimes of layering of shit that you have to drop and then clear and then drop and clear. It's a process. It's not easy. So when people think you're, oh, the ascension, the ascension, the ascension, yeah, it ain't coming for a long fucking while. Why? Because you got to deal with your shit. For some of us, we are already there. We just have to meet the frequency, but we volunteer to help everybody else. So I've talked about this at death's length with Dolores Cannon. A lot of, and even Ashiana Dean, a lot of us volunteer to stay kind of in the middle. Not we're shifting, but we're trying to pull others up the rope. Like, here, come on, come with us. A lot of us are there. And I said it on TikTok, I'll say it here. Even though you claim you're awake and that you know, you really don't. I don't claim to know shit. Why? Because you're only where you are in your frequency. When you raise your frequency, everything expands. The truth expands. So your limited viewpoint of the truth is where you are at in your perception, in your vibratory state. When you rise yourself higher and higher and higher, so many other things are going to fall off that no longer serve you a purpose because it's just, okay, and? Okay, so that person's at Gitmo. Okay, and this is happening. Okay, great. But again, the military should have upheld their oath. Okay, so how much more treason is going to get taken advantage of? Oh, it's a movie, Allison. And yeah, it's all scripted, and that's great. But the reality is, both sides are deceptive, and both sides, I don't care what cog is being conducted, is wrong. It's wrong. So I'd rather feed my energy into helping people elevate and do for themselves and think and clear the energy than to spew the pledge unfaithfully to not uphold it. I love my country and I am a patriot, but both sides are deceptive and both sides are playing games. And at some point, humanity has to take the step up, realize, take your power back. Yeah, you know what? I can jump timelines. I could pull my other selves into different timelines. I could do a lot of things, and so can all of you. No one's separate from those things. So when you put somebody on a podium and a pedestal, idolize, that's also a problem. We're all doing God's work. We all matter. If we're all one, it doesn't matter. We're all one. There's no separation. There's no limitation. It's an illusion. And when you drop the illusion and you see it for what it is, you'll be way better for it. We're just here to take down a paradigm that doesn't serve us anymore, doesn't work anymore. And we just have to patiently do the work. To keep circling that wall until it's time. It's not time yet. Soon, but not yet. So, guys, sending each and every one of you love, light, compassion, grace, shielding, and protective energy. Please go within. Be the shoulder physically for somebody. Be the lighthouse. That's what most of us are here for. Raise the frequency, shine that light into the deepest, darkest places. Seed your truths because someone might not be ready today, but something you said might trigger them and they might start their journey. And please be safe, be seen. It is crazy out there and the weather has been going bonkers all over the place. So please be safe. And thank you all so very much for watching my channel and watching the episodes. My gratitude to people who have been helping me financially. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Such appreciation. I had people help me get the adopt the cats. They saw that I need spiritual fluff balls in the house. Like I need some state, I need grounding from kitties. So they're here now, and I'm gonna go hang out with them and have some lunch. Still have that problem. That's dumb. And yeah, clearing that out too. And so, guys, thank you so much. I appreciate all so many people who are, see, it's attracted to me, it's evil. Who are helping me out. And I really appreciate it. Until the next one, guys. Bye for now.